Welcome back. There is not much change and not much let up in the pressure either. Yes Bank, by the way, is down well over 5% today. It's one of those down days for the bank. GAIL, ONGC, IOC, BPCL. It's across the board selling in many of these public sector oil and gas names as well. Those are some of the trends of the afternoon. Mr. Tulsian, wanted to ask you about GAIL once again. And we keep bringing this up because the valuations perhaps are very supportive. But are you concerned about this cloud on the payout, AGR, what happens, what doesn't happen? Plus the fact that the demerger of the pipeline business, that's also been an ongoing discussion. What would the recommendation be on the stock now?
So, Ruby, I expressed my view on Friday also that if you have the apprehension or the fear of the AGR volatility not being getting seen, because now it has a very good chances that the matter has been referred to the tribunal by the Supreme Court. They were directed the PSUs to go to the tribunal and not to the court, you know, and that is obviously will be giving good relief. But you just can't take anything for granted. It has a probability, maybe 10% of the probability of the liability falling, which I may even say that it has 1%. But if you want to be placed safe, then you just cannot take any kind of comfort from that AGR dues, from whether it is GAIL or, you know, maybe Power Grid or maybe Oil India. So yes, if you want to play safe, otherwise on a pure fundamental basis and presuming that you can carry that risk and, you know, the liability is not going to get crystallized or fall on the heads of these PSUs, then and which is most likely, then definitely the buying is advised, because even the hiving of the pipeline business is seen to be positive, and going forward the valuations, if you take a call on the stock, is seen to be quite compelling.
Oh yes, and you know, let's not forget that actually today the stock is not down. Today it's the dividend impact. It's the ex-dividend by 6.4 rupees. So today the 4 rupee that you're seeing, and if you were to adjust that, technically today the stock is up. There was 6.5 rupee dividend component and the stock's gone ex-dividend today. So the fall is because of that only on GAIL today. But Deepak, that brings the larger question, right? PSUs in general, ONGC today broke the 100 rupee mark. In fact, double digit in ONGC. I mean, when did this happen? It used to be India's, you know, most valuable company, right? Or among the most valuable companies. What has gone so horribly wrong?
You know, I think the PSU tag has now kind of become a negative, a very deep negative. But also, I think the general opinion is that the government is going to milk PSUs for whatever they're worth. They've made ONGC buy one of the PSU companies that they wanted to sell. They might use the excess cash in it for some other purposes. So you can't value it as a regular company. In a sense that it is like a cash cow for the government. It can be used in any manner that the government seems fit, and not necessarily in the benefit of the shareholder. So you will give it a much lower premium. But of course, like all markets, we will tend to blow things overboard on one direction or the other. So we'll pay 80 times earnings for a company that can't grow more than 12%. But at the same time, we'll give like a 2 times earnings for a company because it has a PSU tax. So there will be some point at which this will turn around, I hope. But I'm not an investor, but I don't know if you should catch a falling knife here. You might suddenly see the emergence of bad news that will drop earnings also correspondingly. So wait till it recovers and you actually get some positive news, is what my opinion is.
Mr. Tulsian, your thoughts? Because, you know, it pains, right, to see a stock like ONGC below 100, double digits.
See, Anuj, it pains, but it pains to hear this with respect to Deepak and the earlier expert. I've heard that cash milking the cash cow by the government. You know, in fact, the similar tone was, similar language was used by the earlier expert, you know, in regard to the AGR dues. I don't understand companies, telecom companies have not paid a single rupee in last 20 years. As strictured by Supreme Court, and in spite of that, we are saying we are milking the telecom cows. Similar is the case with ONGC. If you see the 7 rupees dividend having paid, about 140% dividend having paid for FY19, I don't understand this dividend is seen to be too high. And if you are so thrilled that if you don't see the capital value destruction coming in, then definitely one should plunge into buying these PSUs. And if you really ask me, I don't remember of having initiated a buy call on ONGC in the last 3 or 4 years, or maybe even on the my stocks like NTPC kind of stocks. But yes, at 100 rupees, and if you have the similar kind of dividend payout likely, it's very unclear, because probably government may not ask for these companies to declare the dividend before 31st March, because AGR dues is seen coming into the government for this financial year, and they will be shifting it to the next year, and that will really be seen very positive. And I won't be surprised. And if you see the situation, Brent is tested, having tested a floor of about $55, is seen to be really quite positive. So overall, if you really ask me, as I said that I have never been initiated a buy call on ONGC in last 3 or 4 years, but definitely at 100 rupees, I will definitely be plunging into buy the stock, because I can expect a dividend of, if not 7 rupees, 5 rupees for FY20, and that will be giving a good reward. And I may be on a fundamental valuation basis, I may be wrong, but seem to have bottomed out at these prices. So it qualifies a good buy from the dividend yield point of view also. And I don't think that there is any harm if the government goes ahead and asks for the higher dividend from these profit-making companies.
I think that's how we get a perfect market. There is a buyer and there is a seller, and that's what the market is made of. Mr. Dulzin, before we let you go, oil and gas is just, you know, catching so many headlines. And I'm now noticing IGL, Mahanagar Gas, Gujarat Gas. Let's just pull up the intraday charts on all these stocks. They're all again down 2 to 3%. Now, from their peaks, they're down about 6% to 11% from the 52-week highs. Now, this constant chatter, Mr. Tulsian, about the marketing exclusivity ending, open access, there are different calculations that have started doing the rounds on how much it's going to hurt these companies. What are your views, sir, at these levels, if someone has been riding the wave on gas stocks, should they be worried?
Surbhi, again, if you take a call on the valuation differential between IGL and MGL, I won't touch the GAIL or maybe Gujarat Gas at this stage. If I just purely go on the two marketeers, one in NCR and second is in Mumbai region, and if I just take the valuation differential, this is what I've been saying, there is virtually a P multiple difference of, or maybe MGL is ruling at half the P multiple than what IGL is ruling at. Why we have been giving such a high multiple? Because the IGL has been posting a volume growth of anywhere between 12 to 16%, depends on PNG and depends on the CNG. Similar was not the case with MGL, because they were focusing more on the margin expansion. Definitely, because MGL doesn't have any long-term contract, everything they buy the gases in the spot market, apart from the pipe PNG, you know, which they have, they get from the contracted rate from the domestic producers. But apart from that, so giving such a high valuation to the commodity stocks was always seemed to be a risk. But if you get to hear that PNGRB is thinking of dismantling the exclusivity of these companies, then definitely that will be seen quite negative. And more especially the way the things are seen really getting enlarged, or maybe getting explosive growth being seen by the private sector, maybe like Adani or maybe any other players in this space, will really be seen to be quite critical. So yes, at the hefty valuations in case of IGL, which is ruling at a P multiple of 23-24, and MGL at a P multiple of 12-13, is rightly, because we have seen them touching virtually a lifetime high or maybe 52-week high just a couple of weeks back, and post this news having come in of this PNGRB dismantling the exclusivity, we have seen the corrections. In fact, the correction of 10-11% is seen very much within the line if you have these kind of news flows coming in. So probably caution is required, and there is no compulsion to remain invested in the stocks. Then can easily exit even at the current level if you have this fear persisting of monopoly getting scrapped.
All right, Mr. Tulsian, thanks a lot for joining us. We'll talk to you tomorrow. Now, for now, just looking at some more names. Mishra Dhatu is up 20%. That's frozen on circuit. But really, Deepak, I wanted your thoughts as well on the stock of the day, Muthoot Finance. And it's really stolen a march over, Manappuram. Your call on the two stocks.
Yeah, and, to be fair, Anuj, I'm an investor in Manappuram. We've recommended it. We hold it. I really like, both these stocks have been kind of really good in terms of both capital ratios, the ability to control NPAs, and of course, the third one here is also the fact that they are not valued very richly. They're about 10 to 12 times earnings. And if you look at both of them, the growth has been quite spectacular in terms of earnings, in terms of being able to control NPAs, even though both of them have now diversified away from purely gold, they've managed to maintain fairly high net interest margins. And they, wherever they have collateralized security, they both are able to, you know, sell their collateral in a fairly liquid market much before they become large NPAs. So all of these things aside, in fact, you're giving about 10 to 12 times earnings. And the fact that, you know, the appetite for small credit, which is where both of them play in, is almost insatiable. I think it's a market of not eating market share from each other, but of just growing the market, of a growing market in itself. I think there's a lot of scope here, especially because they're at relatively low prices. I am, of course, you know, I'm invested in one of them, so obviously I will be kind of favorable to the sector. But I really think that in comparison with a lot of the other financial sector plays, both Muthoot and Manappuram are able to raise money, both in the short-term and long-term markets, at relatively good rates compared to their, you know, the interest that they charge. Manappuram is able to raise around 6.8% in short term, Muthoot about 6.2-6.3, and remember, these guys you know, have loans at 20% above in their APR. So that way, you know, we've got large margins and controlled NPAs. I like these stocks and I have recommended them, so nothing wrong with this. I hope this is a good run.
All right, Deepak, we'll leave it there today. Thanks a lot for joining us. We're talking to you. Before we move on, just a word on the market. See the Nifty futures, the first genuine buying that you've seen on the index. And that can be interesting because, you know, it was expected that perhaps in the last 1 hour, if the Nifty does not break 12,050, then perhaps there can be some short covering. Are there first signs of that? We'll find out. But you know, today, of course, you don't have any baggage of U.S. market. Tomorrow morning, you won't have that. This is the first genuine attempt of buying that you're seeing on index futures. In fact, the Nifty futures right now, from the low point, is seeing the. If you draw the chart, it's the first big green bar that you have seen. And let's see if it's got some kind of follow through coming today. Let me just see if there's any interesting stock move which is really supporting it. State Bank of India is seeing some recovery. There's some buying happening once again in Bharti Airtel. So there are some stocks, but you know, you can spot it. That's the first bit of move which is visible on the index right now. Let's see if you know, we can continue it towards 330. Amit Khurana is joining us, head of equities at Dolat Capital Market. Amit, hi, good afternoon. You know, you do talk to a lot of FIIs. And you know, you do a lot of business in the derivatives market as well. So I want to understand this kind of shorting that we have seen from FIIs, 16% long exposure, is something we haven't seen. What's going on?
Yeah, so to specific question of the derivatives buildup, I think this is the first time we've seen such a massive short buildup from the FIIs in the last 4.5 months odd. Yes. And why I say that, they were aggressively short post the last year's budget, July budget, which got unwound in the September expiry when you had the corporate tax rate cut.
Yeah.
And ever since that time, they have been aggressively long. Mm. It's the first time we've seen that kind of a buildup happening, and it's sustaining pretty well. Mm. While the markets have not cracked, but it's sustaining pretty well, especially in a few concentrated sectors, shall I say.
But any reason that why that might be driving it? Any sentiment sort of thoughts?
Well, I think there are a couple of reasons that we believe is the case. One, we're through with the earnings season. It's not been very exciting. Not that it was expected to be a great earnings season. You look at the triggers over the next few months, essentially 2.5 months, not very many triggers, positive triggers to look at. And then you have the overhang of the coronavirus issue, which has gone much longer than what we initially anticipated to be the case. So there's been a sort of a cautious buildup that ultimately earnings will take a knock because of this. And India per se doesn't look cheap anyways. I mean, there are pockets which are looking quite expensive. And therefore, the tactical buildup, which you know, sort of happens. And a lot of these positions will tend to be hedging positions as well on the cash portfolio that might be holding. So I would not read too much into as a negative stance to go bearish on India, but I think it's more of a tactical hedge, quite a few.
It's amazing how quickly sentiment turns in the market, right, Amit? Because I remember when the year started up, it was the beginning of a new year, so we were all filled with hope and optimism. And then there were data points. I mean, I remember the PMI numbers looking slightly better. The IIP print was better that time. Some of that is already changing. Now we're discussing, you know, stagflation and things like that. But purely from the Q3 earnings print standpoint, I want to know if you've seen any green shoots anywhere, any sectors, cement, for instance. There was a lot of, you know, build up before the numbers. So what does the report card tell you?
Well, to us, the real theme of the Q3 was tentative commentary. I would not call it negative. I would not call it very positive. But most of the corporate commentary, and we do a lot of analysis on the calls, on the kind of adjectives which come out, and, you know, real buzzword was tentative. So let me give you a few examples. In the last two quarters, we've seen a lot of companies stressing the fact that they are fortifying their existing geographies, existing categories. They don't want to launch new products. They don't want to spread too thin on the marketing. So they are essentially strengthening their existing dominating areas and making sure that whenever the recovery happens, they're able to defend their market shares. Second theme, and this I think got really highlighted in the Q3, was a clear intent on their part to defend gross margins. You've seen some of these companies making price interventions, which is quite contradictory to the situation that you have a poor volume growth. You do not have a very strong visibility, and yet these companies are willing to pass on price hikes.
Is that a good strategy or is that a bad strategy?
Well, yeah. Now, there can be a debate on that. Yeah. I think the price interventions has been very, very selective and very tactical to ensure that the gross margins are defended. It is not to gain on the margins, but just to ensure that they are able to pass on any raw material hike, because few categories have faced that. And we have seen increasing evidence of the corporates being very clear that in an environment wherein I cannot push volumes, it doesn't make sense for me to take a hit on my margins either ways. So I might as well take some selective price
but hikes. You know what, on that a slightly different approach, you know, because the example that comes to my mind is Eicher Motors. Hit a 52-week low and sales were going down. Then they announced a decent price cut for a couple of their variants. I think the next 2 months, sales went up. And we saw that play out. I think it's time companies tried that, perhaps, instead of just relying on the government for stimulus.
Now, auto is a slightly different case. Why? Because you still have an inventory sitting over BS4. In fact, auto is actually the other way around. In fact, we would expect that over the next 2 to 3 weeks, you could see much higher level of discounting happening to clear off BS4. So autos, I agree with you. I mean, there's a caveat there to add. But if you look at the other categories, typical consumer, durables for that matter, the staple companies for that matter, even cement for that matter has raised prices in the Q4 region. So I would say that there's a lot of selectivity towards taking those price corrections or price hikes, depending upon how they see their gross margin and operating margin structures.
If I simply look at the stocks that have done the best so far in 2020, Titan's going to come up, Lever is going to come up, Nestle is going to come up. So therefore the question, was it just the pre-budget sort of expectations and then the rural push? Because I think rural India got whatever it got, not sure about urban. How would you look at these stocks? Because there's no scope for error given the valuations anyway.
Precisely. But ironically, these are the stocks which has actually started performing of late.
Yes.
For the simple reason that you do not have a very strong Q4 visibility for banks, which is a very large component, and they are very richly valued. I mean, leave alone top 4 or 5 banks, the other banks are going to face a headwind because of these new developments that we've seen over the last few weeks. You do not have very many scope for IT services. I mean, relatively, it might outperform, but what's really going to drive your visibility? And therefore, you have a return towards these consumer staple companies per se. And by the way, they were underperforming for the last 3.5-4 months.
But is it sustainable? Do you have the comfort still to buy a Lever at this price or a Nestle for that matter?
In fact, we believe over the next quarter or so, consumer and IT will be relative outperformers, given the positioning as of now we are in.
Okay, by the way, that that's the problem with this market. That green bar that I was talking about on the Nifty future is very quickly getting sold into. So. The problem is every time there's any kind of rally intraday, that's getting sold into, and that's a bit of an issue. But just put out intraday once again on the Nifty, because it was building a nice sort of intraday gain. But again, from the high point, it's once again, it slipped a bit. But it's that kind of market anyway. I wanted your thoughts on banks, because you could have blamed telecom for IndusInd Bank's troubles, but it clearly is more than that, right? And why should HDFC Bank also be down? Is there a bit of a sentiment hit on financials right now?
Well, it is. As I said, I mean, they were not cheap anyways. I mean, HDFC Bank at lifetime highs almost. I mean, Kotak at lifetime highs. And in fact,
IndusInd is not at lifetime high, but
IndusInd is not. But yeah. Then the overhang of the pending issues, especially, I mean, Vodafone is a big exposure for them. And you also have other, you know, sort of issues, how DHFL will pan out, how ILFS will pan out. I mean, March is going to be the provisioning for a lot of these accounts. And therefore, there is a feeling that if you keep getting these issues, there is going to be a potential risk of a sort of a correction here and there building. I'm not building in a bearish case for banks at all. We're extremely bullish on the banks. But I guess the kind of run-up that we have seen in the best performing stocks probably is running its course for the moment. We'll probably see some bit of correction, some bit of absorption of news flows, and see as to how the yields, by the way, behave. I mean, previously we were expecting a rate cut to play out. That doesn't seem to be the case now. So that's another new development that one has seen of late.
Anuj mentioned telecom. I have to ask you, Bharti Airtel. I've just been playing the devil's advocate over the last, you know, I think 48 hours.
That makes you money.
since the ruling came in, 560, phenomenal run.
Sure.
But as you know, Sanjay Kapoor was saying this morning as well, and he's been in the sector for so long, costs will go up if Vodafone folds up. It's not going to be that easy to capitalize on the additional subscribers that you get.
Sure.
You think the best is in the price, or is it only just beginning?
Now, if you're looking at really short term, I think the best is in the price. But you're looking at a structural way. Our basic assumption has been that it's going to be a three-player market. Mm-hmm. Over the last few days, the way the developments are, that assumption seems to be really getting stress-tested, if I were to put it that way. I still believe somehow Vodafone will survive. Let's hope so. Either ways, Bharti is going to be a big gainer in the entire, because they have the balance sheet to support. They'll be a very viable player, a very strong player in the pan-India space, not just localized. So to that extent, structurally, I still believe there is money to be made on telecom as a sector. But given that Bharti has gone up by 60%, you obviously want to absorb that, see how things pan out. And by the way, I mean, also see the other reactions of the government, and by the way, Supreme Court for that matter. I mean, if they sort of tone down their stringent sort of language that they have used of late. So if that gets toned down, maybe that will also be a confidence builder.
Okay, hope is not a data point, you know, and not a strategy, but, you know, there's always
That's
hope.
That's how we
there's
live,
always
yes.
hope. There's always hope that, you know, things will be better. But thanks a lot for taking time out, Amit. Always good talking to you. But we'll take a break and get you the BTST calls from our technical experts.